All right, hello everybody. Welcome to another Bay Area Rust. Tonight we have a great lineup of speakers all about cryptography and security. It's going to be a really exciting night. As always, thanks Mozilla for feeding us and also providing us a space to get together and talk about such great things. So tonight we have Tony's going to cover all of the things happening inside the Rust community. Sean Devlin from Matasano, hopefully I said that right, will be talking about API design. Matthew will be talking about kernel stuff. Huon will be coming all the way from Australia. Will be talking about randomness. And Sebastian from France, I believe, will be closing out the night talking about secure buffers and memory allocation stuff. But before we begin, I just want to point out that we have, I think this is the last Rust event of the year. Next year we have a couple things. I don't know what the agenda is for these other meetups, but I do know that KMC is organizing a whole, like, basically a day-long session all about how to get started contributing to the Rust language and the Rust project.
Like 15 to 30 seconds.
So
that's going to be here.
Speaking, like.
So this is going to be here in January on the 17th, and it's already filled up. So we have currently 6 mentors signed up and 40 students attending. But if other people are interested in being a mentor for this, that'd be awesome, and you can contact me on IRC. Basically, you know, if you've contributed a little bit to Rust, you can help people kind of get started, help them with, like, why does my test run, things like that. So if you have that skill set by any chance, definitely let me know. And then we can have even more people come to this thing. It's going to be great.
Okay. And the last thing that I just want to put it out to everyone that here are a couple of the meetups that I want to try to organize. I know there are plenty of people out there doing stuff with embedded systems, and I've heard hints of, like, some computing and big data stuff. And I would love to hear back from the gaming and the web community again, too. So please come and talk to me if you want to talk about something. Anyway, so that's it. And now it's up for Tony to start off the night. Please give him welcome.
All right. Good evening, everyone. So yeah, my name is Tony Arsiri. I work on the InfoSec team at Square. I was also one of the early contributors to Libsodium. My best pitch for that is it's the only cryptography library that doesn't suck. I was also the co-author of RBNACL, which was one of the first language bindings to Libsodium. So a quick overview of this talk. It's got a lot of parts, but here we go. All right. So we've got to talk about this year in cryptography. It's been a pretty active one, to say the least. So a pretty important question. Is Rust actually a good language for cryptography? I'm also going to go over a bunch of Rust projects I think are pretty interesting. Talk about my thoughts on what a Rust Common Crypto Library would look like. And finally, I want to talk about measuring timing variability in Rust. I'm going to get into that quite a bit. So here we go, part one, 2014 year in review. Are you all ready? So there's a lot of stuff. Here we go. So Java got owned. That's kind of boring. Nobody cares about Java, right? But you probably heard of GoToFail, at least. So iOS got owned. GNU TLS got owned. This didn't really have a name, but people call it GoToCleanup, I guess. You probably all heard about Heartbleed. So memory exposure, private key disclosure. It's pretty bad. There was. So. There we go. All right, sorry. There we go. So we have the TLS triple handshake attack. This is just a protocol design error in TLS. There was a man-in-the-middle attack against NSS called Berserk. Both Firefox and Chrome, but probably nobody actually heard about this because they shipped a fix really quickly, so nobody really noticed. You probably heard of Poodle. So this one got a lot of press despite not being that severe. And finally, we had Windchalk, so all versions of Windows dating back to Windows 95 had a remote code execution vulnerability. And if you thought we were done, we're not quite, because Poodle bites again. Poodle actually affected TLS too. So what sort of themes can we draw out of this? Well, some of these are just fundamental design flaws in SSL and TLS. So I picked these three to kind of represent that, but arguably Heartbleed fit into this category too, simply because the nature of Heartbleed was really weird. So here's an XKCD that tries to describe this. And really the weird thing about Heartbleed, why I might call it an actual protocol vulnerability instead of just they screwed up and exposed memory because it wasn't memory safe, they included this like explicit length in there. So if you can actually see the comic, I'm not sure you can, but it's showing that like you give it a string and you tell it like give me this much back. So if you're handing, let's say, like a C programmer length and they're juggling some other lengths, chances are they're going to get something wrong. So we can go ahead and say Heartbleed was something of an SSL or TLS design flaw, but I would actually say it's more like C is a crappy language. So I programmed C for a decade. When I started doing C, I thought it was like God's gift to programming or something. I kind of soured on it over the years. And really, we see a bunch of these vulnerabilities where, you know, we're kind of like losing on the easy stuff just because C is really hard to get correctly. So let's start off talking about go-to fail here. So this was in the Apple Secure Transport Library, which is their TLS stack for OS X and iOS. There's this really good talk by Anil Mehta of the Google security team called TLS Under Siege. Secure Transport One, worst of the worst, as far as TLS stacks can go. So here's go-to fail. It's kind of small, I'm not sure if you can see it. But hopefully you can see they had this go-to fail twice. And that ended up making the rest of this function effectively dead code, and somehow nobody saw any warnings about that. And there are a lot of ways that we could have prevented this from happening, right? Maybe some mandatory braces, like that could have prevented this. If we had automatic like resource cleanup, so we didn't have to go to handle these failures, right? And maybe go-to should be considered harmful or something like that. So lots of things they could have done differently to prevent this. And speaking of go-to, we also have this go-to cleanup vulnerability in GNU TLS. So I've got two of these in a row that are both go-to based, and you're probably thinking, this one, go-to bad. Like, we just shouldn't use go-to with crypto libraries. But, so actually, this particular one with GNU TLS is about how people represent Boolean values with integers in C. So this was the actual function in GNU TLS that was affected. So it's trying to call this check of CA function, which is trying to assert that a particular CA can be the issuer for the certificate. And you might see on the end there that there's this equals equals zero. And what that's actually trying to do is detect an error. So all the code you see below is the error case there. So it's like, if this returns zero, then we've seen an error. And we need to do all of our error cleanup for that. So sort of the contract of this check of CA function is your typical sort of integer Boolean, where 0 is false and 1 is true. And the problem with this is typically in C, we do 0 is success and less than 0 is an error. So we have this function where some of the functions in the library are following that contract, and this one happens to be following a different one. So if we go look at the source code of this check of CA function, we have a lot of these things it's calling where less than 0 is an error. It's saying this result variable. And then if there is an error, it's doing goto cleanup. And what goto cleanup does, well, okay, so yes. So there are many of these places where it can be less than 0. So the goto cleanup function, it's calling GNU TLS free datum, apparently because distinguishing between datum and data is important. But anyway, it's just returning that result value based on these other functions. And if it's less than 0, it's an error. But then when we get back here, the problem is less than 0 is not equal to 0. So how this is interpreted by this particular function is we have a valid CA. So it would have expected 0 to be an error, but since we have less than 0, it means we succeeded and we can go on. And this resulted in a man-in-the-middle vulnerability in GNU TLS. So how do we fix this kind of error? I guess the C programmer response would be you should have used not equal to minus 1 to mean false instead of saying that 0 is always false. But I think we really just need true and false. Like, if we had a Boolean type, we could have avoided this problem. And maybe getting rid of goto as well could have avoided it. But, you know, when we have this sort of confusion about if 0 is true or false, like, how can we possibly build secure systems? And this is a pattern that's pervasive throughout not only GNU TLS, but libraries like OpenSSL. And when this is happening, it's really hard to understand what's going on, right? So, so some of my favorite documentation, and when I say favorites, yeah, I'm using that ironically, but so this is some OpenSSL documentation, and if you try to read that, I think it'll make your eyes bleed. But I think my favorite part of this is, you know, we're trying to figure out if we have success or failure. And if you see down there at the bottom, there's this case where it's like, when in doubt, just call the function twice. And 0 might mean success, but it might not. So if you're confused, just call it again, and then you'll get 1. So speaking of OpenSSL, we had Heartbleed. Okay, so bad memory exposure. Okay. I'm sure you've all heard of this, so I won't go into the details. But so what was the worst of these of the year? So that's the Microsoft S-channel vulnerability, which is sort of branded Windchalk. So this was a remote code execution vulnerability. If you deal with security at all, this is pretty much the most catastrophic thing that can possibly happen. Especially if you look at S-channel being a library that's supposed to provide security. What actually ended up happening was it ended up being an attack vector and a very, very bad one because it let attackers execute code on what was supposedly a secure system. So how do we fix things like Heartbleed and S-channel remote code execution vulnerability? So we just need memory safety, and these things hopefully shouldn't be a problem. This is a quick review of this section. We've got some anecdotes based on the attacks that happened this year of just features that programming languages could have that might prevent these from happening. So we have the dead code detection from GoToFail, along with the mandatory braces. Mac resource management, so programmers who are trying to write secure code aren't thinking about like managing their own resources at the same time and kind of getting those concerns confused. GoTo's a scapegoat, but you know, if we didn't have it, it would make code easier to understand. True, false, and you know, clearly Rust has more sophisticated ways of dealing with errors than true and false. If we even had a true and false, that would be a great start. And last but certainly not least, we need memory safety to build secure programs. So, is Rust a good language for building cryptographic implementations? Well, if we look at this list of things Rust has, I think we're off to a good start. I think it's solved all the problems I just talked about in the last section. But is that enough? So what problems do we need to solve at a language level to build robust cryptographic implementations? The biggest ones and one of the hardest to solve is timing side channels. So this is the sort of seminal paper by Dan Bernstein on cache timing attacks. If you read over this really quick, what he did was in sort of a lab setting, he had OpenSSL again, favorite library in the world, running on one server, and he had effectively his attack program running on another, and based on timing measurements he made over the network, influenced by cache timings on the victim server, he was actually able to extract private keys. So catastrophic result. We can get AES private keys by making measurements of timings against a remote server over the network. So I've been trying to brand this particular attack since it's kind of poorly known as cache rules everything around me. I have a link to a blog post I wrote about this down there. I'll put my slides up later. Don't worry. But so kind of the bad thing is when we have variable timings in our cryptographic implementations, and I'm not sure how well you can see that, but this is an image of timing variability that Dan Bernstein produced. So it's trying to visualize as you encrypt whether or not your timings are actually constant, whether they're uniform, that kind of thing. So this is the anti-pattern. So this is circa 2005 OpenSSL. And we see this sort of like cloudy, almost random looking image of the timing. And what we're really after is this sort of uniform grid where there's no timing side channels, there's no information exposed via the timings. So there's another timing attack that got a bit of notoriety. This is called Lucky 13. It's a padding oracle attack against TLS. And what you're seeing here is they're trying to use statistics, specifically this thing called the box test, to see if they can distinguish timing information based on whether or not the padding oracle expose some information. And as part of this, they're actually trying to predict the number of CPU cycles in these cases via statistical analysis. And doing this, even though they're going over a network, so the network is introducing all sorts of crazy latency, we get these sort of bell curves when you do lots and lots and lots of requests. By doing that, they're actually able to distinguish timing information down to the microsecond level. So here is a quote from the Lucky 13 paper. It says, like, you know, I've been talking a lot about these timing attacks. Like, do they work outside a laboratory setting? Can people actually use them to affect like real attacks against cryptography today? So the answer is kind of yes and kind of no. So depending on the scenario, there have been many successful timing attacks in practice. In terms of doing it against TLS on the internet, We're not quite there yet, but the real worry is we're almost there. So Modisano, speaking of Modisano, has created this tool, Time Trial, to sort of try to figure out the feasibility of doing these remote timing attacks over the internet. So Time Trial implements the box test. It can do these sorts of measurements and see if it can distinguish the timing variability, which we can use to do things like either break a cryptographic MAC check, so we can break authenticity, or even recover a private key. So Time Trial is open source. It's available on GitHub. The main parts of it are C++ there. It has a GUI written in Python. So okay, so I've been talking a lot about cache timing attacks and timing variability. So how do we actually prevent our applications from being vulnerable to these? So there is a set of rules. Oh my god, that's a lot of rules. All right. So these are available on cryptocoding.net. I don't expect you to read those all, and let me just break them down into a few different sections for you. So first, constant time operation. So effectively, we need to avoid branching on secrets. So this means pretty much every operation we need to do needs to be branch-free. It cannot depend on secrets. We can absolutely not branch on secrets. We can't do table lookups based on secrets. We can't do pointer arithmetic based on secrets. And we can't do loops based on secrets. Another big one, and this is the really fun one with Rust. So Rust is built on LLVM. LLVM is fantastic at optimizing code. The problem is all of these optimizations can be catastrophic in a cryptographic context. So somehow we need to outsmart LLVM and keep it from optimizing our code when we want it to be constant time. We also need clear abstraction. So this, I think, will be covered by Sean in his talk. We need APIs that clearly break apart sort of the abstraction level. So you need APIs that are really high level and easy to use for application developers. And we need APIs that are really low level and sound to build the higher level APIs on top of. Next, we need types. We need lots of types. Everything should be a type. We should always use unsigned bytes to represent binary data. We need types to make sure we don't get confused and use secret data in non-secret context and vice versa. Need to clean up all our secret values. So as I understand it today, Rust automatically zeroes out stuff on drop, which is probably bad because it impacts performance. And so hopefully you get rid of that, I don't know. But for a cryptographic context, you absolutely, absolutely must zero out this data. So we can't just depend on errata of how Rust works today to zero out these secrets. We really need our drop trait to zero them out of memory. We need to use strong randomness. We got another talk coming up on that. And that's it. So those are the crypto coding rules. And the really exciting thing, I think, about Rust is people are already working on solutions of all these problems today. So as far as I'm concerned, while these may be problems today, I think there are really good solutions to every single one of them on the horizon. And effectively, I think Rust is a great language for cryptography because of that. Best of all, I don't think we need to change Rust. I think Rust is fine as is. I think Rust exposes all the features that we need to solve these problems already. And if I have one piece of advice to the Mozillians, it's this ticket. Figure out the Intree crypto story. So I think your instincts were there shouldn't be any Intree crypto story, in this ticket, it was kind of like, should there be? So my answer is no. Just do not put any crypto into the standard library. And my reason for that is putting it in there limits agility. So if there's any issue with the crypto that you put into the standard library, you're effectively gating fixing that on a release of a language. So right now I'm part of an effort in the Ruby community to rip the OpenSSL library out of the standard library and put it into a gem. And the reason for doing that is whenever there's an issue with the OpenSSL extension, we can simply ship a gem, and Rust would be a crate, right? But the idea is that people who are dealing with these things can very quickly fix the issue, put out a new release, and give people an update to fix the problem. And, like, this has been the story of my life this year, right? Like, so there have been just so many issues, and there have been so many cases I've run into where we simply cannot ship fixes fast enough because the crypto is stuck inside of a much larger system, which is very hard to update. And finally, I feel that crypto should be developed and released by crypto experts. So, you know, I mean, there are plenty of crypto experts on the Rust team, and that's great, but, you know, I feel that the people who should be developing these libraries should be very focused on crypto and good turnaround whenever there are vulnerabilities. All right, so I'm going to talk about some of the libraries that I have seen available in Rust. So I think an important question is, what libraries should you be using today? So after all that bound mapping of OpenSSL, the first one I'm going to recommend is Rust OpenSSL. You might be like, but Tony, what about Heartbleed? Like, are you trolling me? but actually, so OpenSSL is by far one of the most mature cryptography libraries available today, despite the fact it's terrible. an awful lot of work has gone into it and is very mature. And there are a couple of forks of OpenSSL that are trying to do good work. So you've probably heard of Libre OpenSSL, where their main MO seems to be, we want to go gut all the cruft, which, you know, that's okay. Google has their own fork called Boring SSL, which is kind of hard to use because they don't do releases, and they just kind of put their code out there. But they are, in fact, doing some pretty fantastic work. Rather than just gutting cruft, they're going around and adding explicit length checks everywhere. So yeah, that's pretty helpful. And I think Libre SSL may be a little bit misguided in that they're focusing more on the cruft and less on fixing the actual vulnerabilities. So next library I want to talk about is Sodium Oxide. So I'm a little bit biased in that I love libsodium. you may not have heard about libsodium before, so maybe you're wondering, okay, is libsodium, is it safe? So libsodium is a portable repackaging of Dan Bernstein's network and cryptography library, otherwise known as NACL, or as he would have you say it, SALT. So originally, if you ever tried to use it, it had this very, very crazy build system where it'd go through and it would systematically benchmark every single possible implementation of a particular algorithm and choose the one that was fastest and produce a totally non-relocatable binary, which has some nice security properties, but operationally it's just a non-starter, right? Like, you need position-independent code so you can just build a library and then ship it, right? Like, so it started with that. This included symmetric cryptography, so specifically authenticated symmetric cryptography, so it has very advanced ciphers, most of which you probably haven't heard of, It was built on an algorithm called Salsa 20, which is very fast, very secure. It's a nice stream cipher. It includes a MAC called Poly 1305 and combines them into this nice little thing called Crypto Secret Box that provides authenticated encryption. And it also included a Diffie-Hellman function called Curve 25519, so you could do mutually authenticated public key encryption. So this is all great. So most people are like, okay, so Knuckle's okay. What about, like, all this other crap that's in Libsodium? Like, what is that? Is it good? So it includes some of these other algorithms, ED25519 and SHA-SHA-20. So those two are pretty boring. ED25519 is a digital signature system based on an elliptic curve, which is, you can call it isogenous to curve 25519. SHA-SHA-20 is just a newer version of Salsa 20. So both of those, Dan Bernstein too. People love Dan Bernstein's like brand, whatever. So there's some other things in here. S-Crypt, it's a password hashing function. It's sequential memory hard, very well respected. Blake 2 is a hash function. It almost won the SHA-3 competition. It is based internally on SHA-SHA-20. S-Crypt, actually the S in there is from Salsa 20. So really these are parsimonious algorithms. They kind of all build upon each other. There's also a hash function in there called SipHash. And this is, it's a little bit weird. It's not a hash function you would actually use to be a hash function, but it's great for being the hash function for a hash data structure in a programming language. And my understanding is Rust uses it, and that's awesome. And then there's some additional utility functions. So basically, I would say this is a very non-controversial, well-assembled library that I highly recommend. All right, so I've just covered two bindings to what I would say are mature C libraries. So let's get into the pure Rust crypto. So I'm going to put a lot of warning labels on this. So I've seen a lot of people trying to do pure Rust crypto, and I'm not sure they're really doing it in a safe way. So hopefully I can cover some of what people are doing today and describe how we might do Rust more safely than I have seen in some of the existing libraries. I'm not even going to call these libraries out. I'm going to try to focus on what people are doing well. But the majority of libraries I've seen people writing in Rust today kind of scare me. So I don't think people have really thought through all of the implications, especially with the elliptic curve libraries. And so I'm just going to talk about the things that I actually like. And I guess I'm saying by default that anything I don't talk about, you might want to be a little bit suspicious of. So first, Rust crypto. So probably everybody's heard of this. So I think it's a promising start. Looks good to me. A lot of the stuff I've seen, it's basically how I would have done it. There's some good implementations, and some that are a little more questionable. And the funny thing is, sometimes good implementations are also the questionable implementations. So the main thing I want to talk about is AES-NI. So this is AES New Instructions. This is a native hardware implementation of AES from Intel. So this is how Rust crypto implements it. So it's doing a little bit of setup there. But as I was looking at this, I was kind of like, what is that? ASENI? Did you mean AES-NI? So just do like kind of a cursory code review and see typos, it doesn't instill confidence. But if we look at what it's actually doing, it has this assembly macro And this is pretty amazing to me. So we have to solve this problem, right? We have to bypass LLVM, and we have to just keep the compiler from interfering with our security critical operations. And the way Rust Crypto does this is by implementing the entire AES function in terms of assembly. It's doing this using the native Intel instructions to do this. So in that giant heap of assembly, there's a few of the AES-NI instructions, but we've got that AES encryption one there. So this is fast and safe, and that's great. So TLDR, this is a really good effort. I didn't immediately find anything wrong with it, although, so it also contains an implementation of AES, which does not use the native instructions. I didn't try to break it, but a bit later in my talk you might see why that's a bit suspicious. I did find these typos and things that make me feel like this is very new bleeding edge code, and we need more expert scrutiny before I can trust it. So next I want to talk about TARs. So Sebastian's going to talk a little bit later about this. So the first things I tried to write in Rust was a very similar library to do protected memory buffers. So I'm going to let Sebastian talk about this, but just as a quick highlight, there are a few things we want to do on buffers that store keys, because keys are particularly sensitive. So we can do these cool things called guard pages, where we effectively set the page before and the page after a buffer to be proton on. And that means if we ever run into a heartbleed, right, if we ever run into a memory exposure vulnerability, something's trying to read the key out of memory, it's going to hit the guard page, and it's just going to segv. So that's great. Mlock prevents these buffers from being swapped out, so you don't actually end up with these secret keys in your swap file. And last, you do a volatile zero on drop. So you can zero out the memory in such a way that all CPU cores will see zero. So I'll let Sebastian cover this. I'm sure he has a lot to say about it. Next one I want to talk about is Rust constant time. And I didn't make the warning super big, but let me just emphasize, do not use this library. it was a cool idea. So they were trying to do was implement constant time versions of all of the Rust primitive types. And they did this in pure Rust. The problem with doing this in pure Rust is it comes with this huge caveat that, like, you know, they have basically written the code in such a way that there isn't any branches in the actual Rust code itself. And naively, that would lead you to believe the code is constant time. But in actuality, they want you to carefully verify the assembly code that this produces. And I don't think that's really a tenable solution. So is there something that we can do to escape these LLVM optimizations where code we write in Rust that is branch-free could actually be constant time? Well, one of them is we could use the ASM macro. We can just simply implement everything in assembly. So this has its own set of problems, right? So it's architecture specific. How many of you think you're assembly language experts? Anybody? Yeah, okay. So, yeah, finding people who can write cryptographically secure constant-time assembly, like, yeah, it's really hard to write. And in the history of cryptography, like, tons of people write things in assembly, and they just constantly screw them up. So assembly almost creates as many problems as it solves. And even once it's written, somebody who's trying to figure out, okay, is this code secure, they have to go read this assembly, and they, you know, they can't tell, like, is this actually secure or not, right? Like, doing the analysis on it is very difficult. So that leads to another question. Is there a way we can take Rust and produce constant time assembly out of it in such a way that the LLVM optimizer isn't going to jump in there and insert branches because it thinks there's something cool it can optimize. So there's a library that does this. So it's called Nadeko. If you've ever seen Klutzy on IRC, he's a really cool guy. He seems like one of those insane geniuses where, you know, I really like what he's doing, but it's like a little bit crazy. But so he implemented a syntax extension for Rust that generates constant time code. And it does this using some pretty interesting techniques. So I'm not sure I can fully endorse it, but I like where he's going. I would definitely call it a science experiment at this point. But he's getting interesting results. So here's his README. So what you do is take otherwise ordinary Rust code, so it only works on a subset of Rust, so it works on like unsigned integers, it works on arithmetic operations, it works on bitwise operations, and it works on very trivial cases of if. What it does is it transforms your original code into this sort of constant time form, and it implements the constant time form of the code as x86-64 specific assembly instructions. So to show you why this is important, so here's some contrived code. So let's say we just tried to write, we want to write constant time code in Rust. And the way we do that is we just implement some code and it just doesn't have any branches in it. And based on the fact it doesn't have any branches, we might naively assume that this code is constant time. But there's a problem, and that problem is LLVM is awesome, and it found out a way to take that original code and stick a branch in there, and now it's faster, but that really isn't what we wanted, right? So using Nadeko, it spits out assembly that is actually branch-free. So quick example, so here is the very, very secure cryptographic algorithm ROT13 implemented in a constant time manner using Nadeko. So again, we're using that const time syntax extension, and we have a very similar looking function there. And I'll show you really quick, if you look at that choose function, it expands into this assembly. So effectively what Nadeko is doing is taking your original Rust code and spitting out a version where every single thing in the code except things like assignments and that kind of thing are implemented as constant time assembly. So yeah, sum this up, so as constant time arithmetic and bitwise operations, and for trivial cases of if, it provides a constant time implementation. For loops are a little bit harder, especially if you're talking about any of them that actually operate on a secret value. So, got another Klutzy project. So he is using this to build a TLS stack, which I think would be particularly interesting to, let's say, Mozilla. I think it would be great if there were something other than NSS or OpenSSL that you could use for a servo-based web browser. So Klutzy has a sort of toy TLS stack that he's built here called Saruga. So it's not a TLS implementation that's really useful right now because it only implements that SHA-20 poly-1305 cipher I was talking about before. Whereas today you probably need AES or something to actually talk to anything. It only implements TLS 1.2 and it only implements the NIST elliptic curves. But there he's showing it talking to Google. So it's pretty much a TLS stack that can talk to Google and nothing else. But I really like it, just reading through the code. It's really well implemented, really clean, and really easy to understand. So I think it's a pretty interesting start. So next I want to talk about what I would like to see out of a Rust Common Crypto Library. So I say that, like, what is a Common Crypto Library, right? Like, what does that actually mean? And isn't that just Rust Crypto? Shouldn't that be, like, the Common Crypto Library of Rust? So I think we need something that's a level of abstraction down. So we actually have a bunch of libraries in Rust. I think they need some sort of shared facilities. Particularly, what I'd like to see is not any, but the bulk of the unsafe functionality forced down into a common library that's shared and can be reused across a bunch of these libraries. So things I'd like to see it do, that zeroing I was talking about before, so when we drop something, we want to make sure it's effectively zeroed out. For the case of keys, it would be nice to have memory protections. I would like to see a lot of this stuff implemented as traits. So, for example, with TARS, it's doing memory protections with mProtect, but there are other ways to do that besides mProtect. It's doing a lot of cool RAII stuff in terms of, like, you acquire it in a protected context, and then when you leave that when you leave that scope, it becomes protected again. So instead of mProtect, you could actually encrypt it, so you can do this thing called key wrapping. So some of the stuff that, like, people are solving is one-off cases. I think I would really like to see traits and generics used to solve these problems. And last but definitely not least, because I've been rambling on about it, I would like to see some sort of solution to implementing constant-time algorithms as part of this library. So here's another case study of where I see this being done in kind of an ad hoc-y manner I don't like. So this is how sodium oxide implements a key type. So they're effectively taking a array of unsigned bytes, and then they're using macros to kind of add these features to it. And sodium oxide does this for every single type throughout the system. So here we see the implementation of it. And it's doing the exact thing I want there, right? So it's using volatile set memory. It's using this LLVM intrinsic to make sure when things get dropped that they get correctly zeroed out of memory. But the problem is, let's say somebody makes one of these types and they forget to run the macro, right, or something like that. Like, just the way it's implemented, I think it's very error-prone. I think Rust has better facilities to handle this sort of thing. So can we do better? I think we can. I think there should be a common foundation for all crypto libraries in Rust, and I think we can have something like a generic secret type. I think we can have traits for protected memory buffers. I think we can have traits for, let's say, hash functions, traits for symmetric encryption, that kind of thing. So I'd really like to see sort of a more pluggable and interoperable way to express cryptographic libraries in such a way that they're easy to swap out, they're easy to compose, that working with these secret buffers, right, you can easily pass them from one implementation to another. I would definitely like to see constant time operations solved in one place. So there are lots and lots of ECC implementations in Rust right now. I'm pretty sure that all of them are insecure. So without something like Nadeco, when their code gets compiled, even if it's branch free, it's going to introduce LLVM is going to introduce branches, and it's going to introduce timing side channels that way. And yeah, as I was saying earlier, if there are common types for these sort of things and common traits, then these libraries can interoperate. You can take some data that you get out of one cryptographic algorithm, pass it into another, and everything will compose nicely. So my last section, So measuring timing variability. So again, I've been talking a lot about constant time. So we can look at people's code and go, that's not constant time, right? But how do you really know? There's the only way you can really actually know, and that's to measure. So to verify any of this code, we need to actually count the CPU cycles that it takes to execute. So modern CPUs do a lot of CPU cycles in a second. So if you have a 2.5 gigahertz processor, it's doing 2.5 billion CPU cycles per second. So 0.4 nanoseconds or 400 picoseconds. So if you recall Grace Hopper telling you, mind your nanoseconds, we're at the point where we are ever so slightly faster. We have gotten to the picosecond level. So how do we actually measure CPU cycles? So in modern x86, we can use a feature called the timestamp counter. So here is a little code snippet of how you can actually invoke the instruction to read the timestamp counter in Rust. So RDATSC, read the timestamp counter. So this is using the ASM macro, calling that instruction, and then we get this value back that is huge. It tends to wrap around pretty quickly simply because when you're doing billions and billions of CPU cycles per second, you're going to exhaust a 64-bit integer pretty quickly. But that's all it takes. So what I would like to do with this is have a library for not only measuring like CPU cycles in Rust, but having a way to actually execute that box test I was talking about earlier and detect timing variability in an automated manner. So I called it Cyclometer. Cyclometer is actually a Enigma-like encryption device from the World War II era. I'm just using it to measure CPU cycles. But what I'd really like to see is automated testing of cryptographic libraries to make sure they're actually operating in constant time. So the way you would do this is sort of like the quick check model. You have some sort of oracle for generating random data. You can either use random data or you can pass the same value back in, and using the read timestamp operation to actually measure the timing, and doing this over and over and over again, we can statistically determine if we can distinguish whether or not the timings are data dependent. So it's again this sort of test that we saw in Lucky 13, where we have these two bell curves, and we're trying to tell if we can actually distinguish them. I think if we can automatically detect these data-dependent timings, we can actually build robust cryptographic implementations. So people won't be guessing, so that's been a big thing I've seen with a lot of the Rust cryptography libraries, is people say, I think this is constant time. And they've written the code, so it doesn't have any branches, but they don't really know because they haven't measured. So only problem with Cyclometer is vaporware. I've been working on it, and I intend to try to fish it up over the holidays here. If anybody would like to collaborate on this, I'm definitely looking for interested people to help work on it. So some final thoughts here. I think Rust is super promising for cryptography. I think there are good solutions to a lot of the problems that people might run into in other languages trying to produce robust cryptographic implementations. I think like Nadeko, if it actually worked, if it actually provided guarantees, and hopefully had multiple implementations across multiple CPU architectures, it seems pretty awesome to me, and I think could potentially be a great way to build robust cryptographic implementations. The other thing, I see a lot of people, again, claiming their code is constant time. simply because they've written it without any branches, and therefore they think it's constant time. But I think if they actually look at the assembly, there are going to be branches that may will vary depending on the optimization level, right? So I don't think we can really trust any code that goes straight through all VM to be constant time. I think for now, people trying to do cryptography in Rust should stick to these wrappers around some of the more, let's say, battle-tested crypto libraries like OpenSSL, even though it's had so many problems over the course of the year, course of many years, right? It's still probably one of the most mature libraries that you can use today. But I would definitely recommend you check out Libsodium and see if it fits your needs instead. So there is a Rust crypto channel on the Mozilla IRC server. So if any of this interests you and you would like to talk to other interested crustographers, I guess, is hop on to this channel, and I think we'd love to chat with you. And that's all I got to say tonight. So I have a blog at tonyrcre.com, on Twitter is Bascule, I'm also on Mozilla IRC is Bascule, or Freenode and GitHub as tonyrcre. That's all I got to say. So I'll take any questions now if people have them.
Hello?
Oh, yeah. I guess I'll do my question. I'll hand this around.
Okay.
So I was wondering if, in addition to doing the timestamp counter measurements in Cyclometer, if you were looking into some cycle-accurate microarchitecture simulators that exist.
So I know DJB wrote one of those. I have not actually looked into any of them. Like, my understanding of them is they're incredibly hard to create accurately, and they involve very, very deep knowledge of the pipelines of those architectures. And it's almost the point, I think, right, by the time you've written one and made it accurate, the CPU architecture you're simulating is obsolete, right? So they seem great, but I don't know if it's really a sustainable solution. So, the thing about using a timestamp counter, right, is you are running it on a multitasking, like preemptive multitasking operating system. So because of that, you're going to get a lot of background noise, and really the simulator would get you an accurate count of the CPU cycles, which would be great.
That's actually what I wanted to...
The
TSC is actually... It's worse than that, because the TSC is independent of the clock speed. It doesn't vary according to the power management stuff. And it may not be in sync across different cores. Multi-core systems.
As a way to describe that, right? You think if you do use the TSC for this, it can't tell you if you've gotten it correct, but it can tell you if you have it horribly, horribly wrong. So that's the sort of test I think would be nice as sort of like something you could do as part of an automated test cryptography library, right?
If you're using the CPU's facilities, you could use the performance counters to measure actual executed cycles and actual memory accesses and cache misses and stuff like that, and that would
be
a much more direct measurement of the stuff that you care about.
So that would be great, but it would be substantially more complicated.
Well,
right?
The other alternative is, rather than doing a microarchitectural thing, is you could do something like modify Valgrind so that you could tag secret data, and then it could just tell you as part of the execution whether or not it did a memory access or a conditional branch based on something you tagged as being secret, and then that would tell you directly whether or not...
So there are clearly, like, more sophisticated formal verification mechanisms you can use for this sort of thing. The nice thing about using CPU cycles, so I was kind of modeling this off of Dan Bernstein's work with something like SuperCop. So what's nice is like the timestamp counter is x86 specific function, right? But Dan Bernstein has a library called CPU cycles, which provides access to similar facilities across a variety of microarchitectures, right? So if you do end up with something like a SuperCop style build farm, where you have just tons and tons of sample machines across different architectures, right? If you really do kind of build all your testing around CPU cycles alone, you can do effectively like continuous integration testing of a cryptography library across a wide variety of microarchitectures without the need to sort of build a more sophisticated mechanism of doing more precise measurements across
all
of them.
Yeah, and also he discovered that different CPUs do different multipliers at different speeds, and like different multiplications at different numbers. So kind of difficult if you're relying on instructions.
So, yeah, clearly this is a very hard problem. the reason why I even want to do something like that in the first place is there really isn't anything right now, and I see a lot of code being produced where people are like, I think it's constant time. And it would be nice to have even a preliminary, very basic automated sanity check of if those sort of statements hold any water whatsoever, I think.
I had another question about scrubbing secrets on drop. And the problem with doing that sort of thing in other languages has always been that the compiler can leave stray copies of pieces of that stuff lying around in registers or in stacks.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if there's any way of expressing in Rust that this is a thing in which you should not copy anything or leave traces lying around.
So there's lots of ways to do that both in Rust and at the POSIX level. So one way you can do that is use mmap, and Sebastian will probably talk about this with TARS. So you can do mmap, you can do map and on, you can map in 3 pages worth of data effectively, and then you can do map shared, which is kind of counterintuitive. So there's 2 flags, there's map shared and map private. So map shared will ensure if you fork that the data ends up shared across both processes. So if you zero it in one, you're guaranteed to zero it in the other, which may not be what the other process is expecting, but the flip side is if you do map private, it'll do copy on write. So when you're trying to zero out the memory, all you're doing is making a copy and then zeroing out the copy and leaving the original around, right?
Well, I was thinking also about stuff just being left on the regular stack.
So there, again, I think Sebastian will talk about this with TARS, but there's some really cool, like, RAI-style techniques you can use with scopes to prevent that from happening.
Okay.
So, yeah, you might want to ask him when he gives his talk.
Yeah. I think we're actually out of time.
Okay, cool.
A lot more.
All right, cool.
We'll have plenty of time afterwards for more questions. Right. So, thank you, Tung.
Okay. All right, Sean. Hopefully this will work. Where's the full screen button? Okay. All right, Sean, can you speak? Oh, no, don't hear you quite yet. Mike, do we have sound up here? Sean, can you say something again? Oh, no. Hold on. All right. Can we hear you yet? No, we can't. Oh, no. Let me play some hold music. This work? Okay, so Sean, I'm gonna reconnect just in case. Can you try speaking now?
Can you hear me?
Okay, great. Hold on, don't say anything because you're really loud. Are we good? Okay. All right. John, here is everybody.
Hi, guys. So I'm going to get started. Following the slide, but I just wanted to say hi first, but I'm going to do that now. So the next 20 minutes is going to be a disembodied voice talking to you about crypto. So here we go. All right, can you guys see my screen now? I think so.
Yes, we can.
Okay, cool. So I wanted to talk to you guys a little bit today about crypto interface pitfalls and how to avoid them. Basically, just how to design a good high-level API for a crypto library. First off, just a little bit about me. My name is Sean Devlin. I'm a principal consultant with Matasano Security, and I mostly focus on cryptography kinds of things. I'm also a member of NCC Group's Cryptography Services. NCC Group is the parent company to Matasano. And Cryptography Services is a team we put together with some of our sister companies, including ISEC Partners and Intrepidus Group, to kind of focus on cryptographic assessments, sort of across all of our clients. A little bit about Matasano. Matasano is an application security consultancy based out of New York, Chicago, and just down the road from y'all in Sunnyvale. And we are hiring, so if you're interested in security or, if you like what you hear tonight, consider reaching out. So with that out of the way, let's get on to interfaces. So the first thing is why I talk about interfaces. I spend a lot of my time looking at application level code, and in my opinion, really the weak point in cryptography across applications right now is basically the library interfaces that application developers are dealing with. We have all these secure constructions, many of which Tony talked about in his talk, but they're not getting deployed securely for whatever reason. And even just going past some of the things he talked about, like cache timing attacks on AES, we're seeing much simpler problems at the application level. So developers deploying ECB mode or using a static ID for encryption, forgetting to authenticate their ciphertext, these simple problems that lead to really bad bugs. Which is very understandable because application developers, are typically not experts in cryptography, but with the interfaces that we sort of designed and deployed across a number of different platforms, we're basically requiring them to be experts to do things safely. Sorry about that. So many of the problems that I just talked about are basically solvable at the library level. For example, we can get rid of unauthenticated ciphertext problems by simply not exposing an interface for unauthenticated ciphertext. And then lastly, I think interfaces are a good area to focus on because, as I mentioned, I think this is the weak point right now, and so this is an area where we can really make a big impact on application security if we focus on it and take some time to get it right. Okay, so what are some of the things we're going to be talking about here? This is basically a list of the topics, problems that I see across some of the libraries that I'm looking at. The first one off the bat, there's just way too many choices. Like I said before, we're basically requiring application developers to be, experts in cryptography in order to secure their systems. They need to tune all the, the right knobs and buttons in order to get things just so. A related problem, we have unsafe default settings for a lot of things. So like ECV mode I mentioned, this is the, you know, the famous picture of Tux the penguin that's encrypted, but you can still tell what it is. This is the default mode of operation in a lot of different libraries, and I'll have some other examples of that. Unauthenticated encryption, another thing I mentioned. So, you know, encryption gives us confidentiality, but it doesn't guarantee authenticity. A lot of times developers think this isn't a problem. They think, you know, the attacker doesn't know the plain text, so he's not going to be able to modify the ciphertext in any way. But this turns out not to be true, and it leads to a lot of problems. Initialization vector, or IV, and non-selection. So a lot of algorithms require, you know, basically a random or unique seed in order to guarantee the security of the construction. And basically across libraries, we're leaving that responsibility in developers' hands, and it often has, you know, disastrous consequences that I'll go into. Secure random number generators across a number of platforms are, you know, just not very well, you know, they tend to focus on user-land secure random constructions instead of just relying on, you know, what the underlying operating system is providing in the form of, you know, dev urandom, or in the case of Windows, their cryptgen random API. And then, you know, we also have some, basically what I would call gaps in APIs, where we're providing developers with an interface that, say, might require a random key, but then we're not giving them the function to actually generate the key. Or, you know, another case might be a function to verify a MAC in constant time. We're basically leaving that up to the users themselves. This is something else Tony talked about in terms of like making sure that operation is constant time. And that's something we can take out of the developer's hands and, you know, basically safeguard for them. And then the last thing I want to talk about is the notion of a password hash, which is basically a hash function that's slow by design, so it's suitable for storing user credentials on servers, which is something that's, you know, missing from most standard cryptographic libraries that are out there. Okay, so to start off with, you know, too many choices across libraries. Too many choices for block ciphers, too many choices for modes of operation, MACs, padding schemes, random number generators. I think this is the number one problem we have in crypto libraries. We're basically overwhelming the user with choices. And since most users aren't experts in cryptography and really shouldn't have to be, we're basically, you know, overwhelming them. So, for example here, Tony talked about OpenSSL right now. So this is just a list of the different symmetric ciphers that the current version of OpenSSL supports. And if you just look at it, it's gigantic and bewildering. Like, it's just this big list with basically all these things are presented as sort of moral equivalents, but there's no... I mean, if you just look at this list, there's no really way to tell, I mean, which of these modes have a built-in authentication, which ones require an IV, what are the requirements for the IV, does it need to be unpredictable, does it just need to be unique? So if we're looking at that and we have trouble figuring out what exactly to do, you know, the application developer without much of an interest in cryptography and maybe with less expertise than we might have, you know, they're going to be in quite a bit of trouble. So what should we do instead? I think what we really want is just a sort of a curated list of a very few good choices. And really what we want to do is we just want to target the needs of the vast majority of developers, because we can't really anticipate the needs of the corner case anyway. One interface I really like is there's a recent library in Python that is, you know, imaginatively just called cryptography. And it basically splits up its constructions into two levels. It has the recipes layer, which is, you know, high-level constructions, you know, safe for end-user consumption. And then it has the hazardous materials layer. And this is a bit more like what Tony was talking about when he was talking about sort of the common core of, like, very low-level primitive cryptographic constructions that you might use to build something like the recipes layer. So most of the things I'm going to talk about are going to be focused on, you know, what we want the recipes layer to look like. But I think this is kind of a way of dividing up a crypto library that makes sense to me. And it also gives you kind of like an easy path for deprecation. So suppose something from the recipes layer is later found out to be unsafe, you can kind of transition it to the hazardous materials layer over time and replace it in the recipes layer with something better. Okay, so unsafe defaults. I talked about this a little bit before. You know, in lots of libraries, if you just ask for an AES cipher, what you're going to get is an AES cipher working in ECB mode. This is sort of the textbook unsafe way to do encryption. This is a, you know, basically just divide up the plain text into blocks and encrypt each block separately using the block cipher. And it has obvious bad properties, as in the famous picture of Tux the penguin that's encrypted, but still, you know, obvious what it is. But even on top of that, there are more problems. It's highly malleable. It's easy for attackers to forge messages. It's you know, an attacker with plain text control can easily recover quite a bit of other plain text. In addition to this, one thing that we see all the time is with RSA encryption, basically defaulting to this unsafe padding mode called PKCS1. Now, there's been known attacks against this padding mode since the late 1990s, and yet still to this day, you know, across several libraries, and this documentation snippet here is from Ruby, OpenSSL, you know, basically we're defaulting to this known unsafe mode, which you know, is vulnerable to these known attacks that allow plain text recovery. This is something we find pretty regularly at Montesano, just because, you know, this is the default mode, so application developers are going to assume that this is, you know, a safe, sensible default choice. When really that couldn't be further from the truth in this case. So what do we do instead? Well, I think what we want to do is, if possible, avoid even having a default. Because a default implies that there's a choice there, and I think for like a high-level library, you really want to remove as much choice as possible. If some kind of choice is necessary, then you need to make sure that the default you supply is the right one. So really the consideration here should be that security, you know, a secure choice should be the default, and, you know, something that supports more of a compatibility type of profile, which I think is what is going on with PKCS1 being so widespread. You know, that should be the opt-in. So, yeah. The third thing I want to talk about is, you know, unauthenticated encryption. This is, you know, basically, as I mentioned before, confidentiality is something we get from encryption, but authenticity is not something that we get from encryption. For that, we need, you know, typically some kind of MAC construction, like HMAC is popular. There are some modes that integrate the two. But unfortunately, you know, we're giving the user lots of choices and not necessarily communicating what the potential downside to having unauthenticated ciphertext is. And those results can be catastrophic often. If ciphertext is unauthenticated, you know, an attacker can often tamper in, you know, well-understood ways with the plain text without even necessarily knowing what it is. So for a stream cipher, for example, the way it works is you generate an unpredictable keystream, and you basically just XOR that against your plain text, and that gives you your ciphertext. Now, what that means is that any individual bit that you flip in the ciphertext upon decryption is going to result in the same bit being flipped in the plain text. So even if the attacker doesn't necessarily know what the message says, if he has some idea about some parts of it, he can flip bits to, you know, introduce potentially bypasses in application logic in some settings that could lead to remote code execution, or just code execution, I should say. There are some attacks that can exploit this kind of thing to recover plain text. This is sort of the famous CVC padding oracle, where an attacker will repeatedly tamper with a ciphertext and send it back to the server, see how it responds, and then use that to make inferences about what the plain text must be. And then by iterating over that process, you know, hundreds of times, they could eventually work their way back to recover the entire plain text. And I want to emphasize that, you know, these are all problems for which an authentication code covering the ciphertext is a decisive defense. You know, none of these attacks would even get off the ground if we had authenticity. The problem is that most libraries, you know, are some assembly required kind of things. You know, you need to take these primitives and put them together yourself in the right way. You need to make sure to first, then authenticate. Otherwise, you might be vulnerable to some kind of timing attacks. You know, lots of things that an application developer just might not know about. But it doesn't really need to be this way. I mean, we can basically restrict our recipes layer not even to exposing unauthenticated encryption. We can basically just put a function together that does the encryption, then performs the authentication of it for the user. And a good example of this that Tony mentioned a little bit is NACL. And so this is what their secret key encryption API looks like. You can see that basically the user supplies a message and an nonce and a key and gets back the ciphertext. What this doesn't really say right here is that the ciphertext includes an authenticity tag. So if you try to manipulate any given bit of the ciphertext when you go down to call the open function, the message is just going to be rejected, and it's not going to leak any information about what the particular mode of failure was. It's basically just going to stop the attacker's, you know, attempts to forge data or recover plain text. So there are, you know, good examples we can follow to make these kind of guarantees. So a similar problem is the responsibility of selecting an initialization vector or a nonce. What this is basically a seed that is required by a lot of cryptographic algorithms, particularly encryption functions require an initialization vector or a nonce to guarantee that the ciphertext is going to be randomized with each encryption. So if we, this is basically to prevent an attacker from carrying out you know, basically a dictionary attack on a piece of ciphertext. If the encryption was the same every time, they could submit a bunch of different guesses for what it might be and then compare it to the ciphertext that they don't know what it is and then see what it is. So the initialization vector basically is to prevent that. It's to make sure that the ciphertext is totally different every time we encrypt it, even if we encrypt exactly the same data. Now, for a lot of different algorithms, the requirements for the IV varies in ways that aren't totally obvious. So for something like CVC mode, it's required that the IV has to be totally unpredictable, so it needs to be random data. But for something like counter mode or the protocol NACL has defined, it's really only required that the IV be unique. So you can use a simple counter if you want. So basically putting the onus on the user to manage those requirements is sort of a recipe for disaster. And again, this is something that we don't really need to expose through the user interface, which is basically the API to our library. What we can do instead is just generate a random IV for them, and don't even accept an IV as a parameter to the encryption function. So like an example of this, this is kind of what I think the API for a symmetric encryption library should look like. So you have the encryption function that takes a key in plain text, and it gives you back a tuple, including the IV, the ciphertext, and a message authentication code. And then the decryption function takes the key and then that same tuple and then gives you back the plain text or error message depending on, you know, whether the authentication code verified. And so you can see with a construction like this, this is very similar to what NACL has defined. And there's basically, you know, no assembly required here. The user doesn't really have to worry about managing those IV requirements. They don't have to worry about, you know, verifying the MAC in constant time. It's just sort of all taken care of for them. So moving past that, we have a wide range of different secure random implementations in different libraries. And there has not been a great track record for that kind of thing over the years. So some examples, Debian had a bug in their OpenSSL implementation a few years ago that led to a bunch of people having the same SSH keys. Android had some problems with their random number generator, I believe, that led to some nonce reuse with some Bitcoin key ECDSA signing operations. So there's kind of a lot of problems there. And a lot of these are attributable to having secure random implementations that are basically, you know, re-implementing a random number generator, you know, up in user land, even though there's already one running for you down in the kernel. And that's in the form of devurandom on Unix platforms or the cryptgen random API on Windows. It's really something we don't want to do because the user land random number generator we layer on top of those things is depending on them anyway. So what we're doing is really just introducing another point of failure, as you can see in some of those examples. Another problem with some of these implementations is that they're often undocumented as to what the implementation is exactly, which you know, is just bad for auditing and dependability. You kind of don't know what you're getting, and you don't really know if the implementation is going to change underneath you in a later version of the software. So like, for example, Java's secure random behavior can vary by platform, by JDK version, it can vary by cryptographic provider. And then Ruby's secure random, so this is a snippet from their documentation. This is actually a slightly older version of the documentation, to be fair, but it basically says nothing about what secure random is doing under the covers. And then if we go look at the actual code, we can see it's doing some weird stuff. So first it looks for OpenSSL. If it finds it, it tries to add in some entropy in the form of a timestamp and the PID. If OpenSSL is not there, it falls back to urandom instead of just using urandom in the first place. The code continues on past this. It goes on to look for cryptgen random. But the point is that none of this stuff is really documented or guaranteed by the API, so it's not really something you can depend on to be there in the future. As a point of contrast, I want to show this is from Go's documentation. And there, you know, it's very simple and direct. This uses devurandom on Unix, and it uses cryptgenrandom on Windows. And I think this is really the example anyone would want to emulate. So API gaps. Basically, what I want to say here is that the API you define should have all the functions a user needs to satisfy the API you defined. So an example of this, this is from Node.js's built-in cryptography library. And so basically what we have here is a fairly standard function they're using to spin up a symmetric cipher using a given algorithm, key, and IV. Now, it doesn't really even say here what the requirements are for the key and the IV, but if you look through the rest of the documentation as well, it doesn't give you any functions for generating those things. So you're basically leaving the user to their own devices. So, you know, the best case is they'll go find a good random function that taps into the kernel random number generator and get those things. But in the worst case, they might end up with some other random number generator. They might end up, you know, just hard coding these things into the source, which is unfortunately something that we end up seeing a lot of the time, just a static initialization vector baked in. If your interface depends on a random key, you should have a function that generates a random key, even if it's just an extremely thin wrapper around the random number generator you have defined. You should give the user a clear path to satisfy the demands you want to make. Similar problem is MAC validation. You don't want to put the burden of constant time verification on the user. You should just give them a function that, you know, takes a message and a MAC for it and validates that MAC. And then the last thing I want to talk about is password hashing. This is somewhat of a specialized use case, but it's a pretty common one nowadays. It's basically universal to web applications, maybe less prevalent in other environments. But basically the problem here is that so we want to store user credentials on our server in some format where they're going to be reasonably safe in the event of a breach. So what we would think about doing is using a cryptographic hash function. Unfortunately, the majority of cryptographic hash functions are built for speed, which is bad for passwords because the search space for passwords is very small. And so this is going to allow an attacker to do just a dictionary attack to basically recover passwords very quickly. And even doing things like adding a salt in is not really an effective deterrent against this kind of attack. So the answer to this is a password hash, which is basically just a hash function that's designed to be very slow. And some examples are, bcrypt, scrypt that Tony mentioned, and people use, pbkdf2 also. Basically, they're all good. I mean, you can just pick one. You really won't go wrong. I think bcrypt and scrypt have simpler interfaces than pbkdf2, so I would tend to favor those. But really, you just need to pack something in there. So just final recommendations for building a library. This is something Tony touched on quite a bit, but NACL is like a great foundation. It really has most of the things you would need in there. Libsodium that he mentioned also fills in like a number of the blank spaces in terms of like having scrypt in there as a password hashing function. I have bcrypt here, but really you won't go wrong either way. And then rely on the kernel random number generator for your randomness. So that's all I have, unless there are any questions.
Okay, so my question is, it seems like a lot of the complexity we see comes from the fact that the crypto primitives that are standardized are super low level and require tons of configuration to use sort of the math that people standardize. Like RSA requires you to know a mode and a mask generation function, and you need to put a hash function in two different places and pick a salt length to like fully describe the specification of what you're using. Is there any thought or direction to trying to give standards to higher level primitives where the construct itself is completely safe instead of asking each library to pick its own set of higher level constructs?
I guess I would say that the most prominent example of that that I would know about would be NACL. And if you go track that down and look at it, it's basically an attempt to provide a high-level cryptographic protocol that meets, you know, the majority of needs for different scenarios. It has, you know, digital signatures, public key, authenticated encryption, secret key encryption. It really tries to cover a lot of bases and take a lot of the potential opportunities for misstep out of the user's hands. I'm not aware of I guess that's the main one I know about.
Any other questions? Oh. Yeah. Nope.
Very good. So the other thing I'd say look at is JOSE. So that is an IETF standard mainly for representing encrypted data, or representing encrypted data at rest. So it's JavaScript object signing and encryption, I believe. So it specifies, it's basically an alternative to the cryptographic message standard from X509, but it's completely built on authenticated encryption. So it's very high level and pretty easy to use, I think.
Oh, yeah. Nope.
All right. Hello?
Hello?
Okay, I think it's right. So, sort of on the topic specifically of Rust and crypto, I think there's a pattern in Rust as a whole of providing these safe primitives on top of unsafe operations, specifically in the context of memory safety, but the same idea, I think, is applicable here. So as we provide stuff like in the Rust standard library VEC, which is on top of raw memory allocation and stuff, and resizing, I think we also definitely need to provide something like the NACL, where it's just magical encrypt function with key, magical decrypt function with key and such things, and some stuff for public key stuff. I think most users don't say, oh, I need to send this across the network with AES, and then I'm going to use HMAC on top of that. They say, I want to send this and make sure Eve in the middle doesn't intercept that. And so I think having sort of opaque APIs is important. And I was wondering if you knew of anything that was actually trying to do this in Rust?
I don't actually. I'm actually not too deeply involved in the Rust community.
Not yet.
So that's a little bit mysterious to me. Maybe Tony has a better idea of that.
Thank you.
All right. Any other questions? Okay. Well, thank you so much, Sean. I hope you have a pleasant evening. And now we're on to Matthew.
All right. So we've heard a lot of good advice tonight on how to write crypto. So if you want to ignore all of it, or at least almost all of it, you can play with something that I think is pretty cool, and that the Linux kernel actually has a crypto API inside of it. And that's used for a bunch of stuff like disk encryption, network encryption, but it's actually exposed to user space. So I want to start off with saying that there's some good advice and you should probably listen to it. I'm not an expert. I don't know what to do. My code doesn't work, like literally doesn't work, unless you have some kernel patches and make some symlinks. And I stole this slide from Tony while, made my best copy of it. So the Linux kernel has this crypto API, which exists because, one, you have a bunch of in-kernel users, and like that's pretty cool, but most people aren't writing their Rust code in the kernel right now. But the real reason that I think it's cool is that it has drivers in the kernel that give you hardware acceleration. On x86, you get AES-NI, which is just instructions, so you can call them from user land. But lots of embedded devices and stuff, which is kind of what I'm interested in, have actual hardware peripherals that are connected over like a bus to your CPU, so you need a real in-kernel driver to talk to them. And drivers for those exist in the Linux kernel. So you get hardware accelerated crypto, which on your little tiny Internet of Things device or whatever, which is a market that really could use some more security than it has right now, you get to use an actual implementation of crypto as long as you have a Linux kernel, which increasingly is becoming everywhere. API that's exposed to user space basically has a lot of the flaws that we've talked about. You have to like parse this text file in proc crypto to figure out what's supported, which if you're doing in Rust is probably fine. You open a bunch of sockets, you like pass some magic strings that you have to like hope or write to bind. You accept, you pass some file descriptors around, and then you call like send message with these like complicated C structures. Which are kind of like the super complicated things that everyone would get wrong in C. Lots of like different length parameters. The length parameters are different sizes, so you probably get like overflows and stuff if you aren't careful. And it's the sort of thing that can go wrong, so it would be nice if we could use this from Rust. One of the problems is that there doesn't seem to be many people who actually use these user space interfaces. I only found like 4 people on the entire internet who use them. Crypt setup, which sets up your encrypted disk, which kind of makes sense because once the disk is encrypted, it uses the kernel APIs in the kernel to use it. Blues, I think I spelled that wrong, actually. I think it's supposed to be a Z on the end, which is a Bluetooth stack. And someone like wrote an OpenSSL implementation for it, but that's not even in their tree. And like someone else's code on GitHub, which is about as mature as mine is, which is to say that it's not. About a month ago, one of the kernel developers or someone submitted a patch to the Linux kernel and had a test library with it, which is like the most mature code that I've seen with it, which is, it's still an evolving interface. So you can use this from Rust. It's like not super easy because at the end of the day, it's kind of a gross C API. Part of it because that's the Rust libc, is missing a bunch of the things you need to use this. The send message system call doesn't have a mapping in the libc, which has been on my to-do list to fix, but I haven't yet. And it takes an IOVEC, which is like a linked list of buffers, which we don't have a mapping for. It has a bunch of constants that you have to pass to various things. The most notable ones is like AFALG, is the socket type, is like some number. So you can probably get those right pretty easy. There's a bunch of variable size C structs, which would be nice if you had like DST things in Rust that could map to them, but you can't really do it exactly because you have to get the representation exact and you can't control that representation super well in Rust yet. And even when you do write your Rust code, you end up using a pile of unsafe code. So it's not, super good. But as I said, this libkc API popped up recently on the internet, kind of halfway through me making my slides, which was kind of interesting because I had to change a bunch of them to be more accurate. So there are some bindings that I wrote for this, and you can use them if you want to make all the mistakes we talked about earlier about having to explicitly provide IVs and keys and modes and stuff. But it's a toy, right? So I say it's fairly simple to use in that it isn't many lines of code, but like if you look at line 4 of this, I'm setting the IV to zeros, setting the key to zeros. You know, you got to get these things right, and, well, this code doesn't. So I feel bad leaving that slide up because it's got terrible, terrible code on it. But there's some links here. I think the third one at least is dead because I haven't posted that to GitHub yet. But there's some interesting stuff here. If you're working on embedded devices, I think we can probably, you know, do some of the stuff from the last talk, maybe work together and get a nice, easy-to-use API written on these primitives. So I'm kind of maybe soliciting some input here from anyone who wants to try and make something good based on this. Or, you know, well, that slide's in the wrong spot. Or based on Dev Crypto, which is the OpenBSD equivalent, and there's a Linux implementation too, which is out of tree, so that means no one will ever use it, because you really don't want to require your users to like load a kernel module to use your code. That's not going to happen, but it does have a pretty good benchmark and some sample code for C in there, which translates into Rust. Do you have any questions? That's about all I've got to say.
So if
you need a microphone.
If you had a Rust library that, you know, appropriately leveraged AFALG, would it be, how difficult would it be in idiomatic Rust to leverage that into, you know, being able to do zero copy while computing a hash of a file and sending it on a sock and sort of the other cool things you can theoretically do with this?
I don't think you can do some limited copying stuff. I mean, Rust is kind of copy happy in a bunch of places in idiomatic Rust. A lot of, you know, moves in Rust use copies implicitly, and actual capital C copies in Rust. But I think if you were to write a nice wrapper around the IOVEC interface, which is the scatter gather IO zero copy stuff from the Linux kernel, then you could actually fairly simply use like capital R readers and writers from Rust to do zero copy or limited copy encryption with this kind of things.
I've been writing a binding for libaio in Rust, and I did a IOVEC as part of that.
Cool.
And I think it probably covers similar issues in terms of kernel interfacing stuff.
Right. Yeah, I mean, this part of the reason why the code that I linked in the slide sucks is because I half-assed the kernel interfacing stuff. So if you've got something better, that's pretty good to make this code less terrible. Yeah. All right. Anyone else got any questions? All right. And I will slide to the next talk.
All right. Next up is Hyun and Aaron. I hope you got, you know, a lot of inspiration for getting send message working.
Yes, I think you do.
Hi everyone. I'm Hyun. I've traveled all the way from Australia to do this talk. Well, not quite. I've been traveling around the U.S. for the past 2.5 weeks, and I've been writing these slides for the past 2.5 days. So they're not perfect, and the title is kind of appropriate because it's a random grab bag of stuff about random numbers. If you want to look at the slides, they're at this URL while I'm going through the talk. So anyway, the first thing we should do is talk about what is randomness on a computer. What is digital randomness? So it's basically just a series of bits that are random. Like, you don't know what each bit is going to be. Normally, they'll be generated in chunks, so bytes or U32s or U64s. So in this case, bytes, and then you might hack up that stream into bytes, U32s, F64s, or whatever. So then why do we care about randomness? What's it useful for? Well, we saw people talking before about randomness for IVs and nonces and so on. But there's lots of other uses. So there's like simulations. If you've got scientific or statistical or testing simulations you want to do. In games, if you're shuffling cards, that's obviously wants to be random. If you're assigning some monster how much gold he will give you when you kill him, that wants to be random, in some games anyway. And in security, as I said, you've got keys, session IDs, IVs, all that. And all of them want quality, some sort of quality anyway. It differs between the exact application, but they need to be high quality, otherwise you'll have people sort of predicting your poker hands. There's an actual case of online casino, people exploiting it because the random number generator wasn't very good. They could guess what the cards that other people had were, which gives you a little bit of an advantage in poker, to say the least. So anyway, what is quality? If you've got a random stream, you want, normally, want each bit to be 0 or 1 with equal chance, and you also want each bit to be independent of all the other bits. So that if you know everything except for one bit, you still can't guess what that last bit is. You can't always get both of these. The first one is relatively easy. The second one is much harder. And it's much harder because a computer is basically deterministic. Like you've got some algorithm and it will give you some results and it will always be the same. So you can get around this with like quantum mechanics or heat noise and so on. And so you've got hardware random number generators that are real random number generators that like look at nuclear decay and stuff like that. But in practice, that doesn't really work for consumer hardware. We'll hopefully get more stuff like this in future, but not right now. So a normal RNG computer random number generator basically takes some initial seed to set up the internal state, and then as you try and get numbers out of it, it'll update that state and give you some random number as it updates. And then this pattern, the sequence of random numbers, is entirely determined by what seed you gave it at the start. So if you want unpredictability, you can't let the others, like whoever wants to predict, know what the seed was or know what your state is. Because once you have the seed, or once you have the state, you know the exact stream that will come out of the random number generator. It's all deterministic. And so for cryptography, it's normally extremely important that the attackers do not know what your internal state is, because they can't be able to predict the, you don't want them to be able to predict the stream. So there's some random number generators where it's obviously bad. If you look at the implementation of XOR shift in the standard library, which is the canonical implementation of XOR shift, a random number generator algorithm, it's clear that it's basically just reading out its internal state. So that's not cryptographically secure, because the attacker can just look at four numbers in a row. If they can look at 128 bits, then they know the full internal state and can predict every random number from that point. On the other hand, a good random number generator is ChaCha, which is again by Bernstein. We saw it before. And so that one doesn't reveal its internal state and doesn't reveal its seed. At least I think I'm not sure if it's been formally proved that it's cryptographically secure, but it's suspected that it is. And so now I've given like a brief intro to random numbers and what's good about them, and now I'll talk about what's good about Rust for random numbers. So the first thing is thread safety. So it's kind of unusual, but it's often the case that you'll have basically a global random number generator, which is extremely unthread safe. So like in C, the rand function, it takes no arguments, it's just updating global state. So you get data races and all sorts of problems, like shared random numbers between threads. If you just call that thread unsafely. And this is a case in the old languages like C and R, and also in the new language like Julia. They've recently started fixing this, but it's like a very subtle problem because most of these libraries are written with the global state in mind. But of course, in Rust, we don't have this problem. Like the default situation is things are thread safe. So you have to go out of your way to make things not thread safe. So our random number generator is thread local, by default anyway. Like each thread gets its own instance of our default random number generator. And so we don't have thread safety problems. We don't have threads getting the same random numbers. The second thing in Rust is SIMD. It's not perfect. There's lots of improvements that could be made. But what we have does work reasonably well. So for example, this is C implementation of the DSFMT algorithm. It's not cryptographically secure, but this is just to provide a comparison. So it's got these complicated intrinsics with kind of strange names. It all makes sense if you've used them before, but when you're looking at it, you still have to interpret carefully what like SLLI EPI 64 means, shift left with 64-bit integers. So that's not so nice. But in Rust, we've got operator overlaying, and it all works nicely with SIMD. So our 11 lines of C is just 4 lines of Rust using the operators you'd expect. So that's kind of nice. You might think, like, doesn't this abstraction get in the way? Not really. So if you look at the assembly, it's basically the same thing with the instructions in a slightly different order. And if we look at the benchmark, so this is the time to sum up 1 billion random 64-bit floats, and it's basically the same between the C and the Rust. So that's using the C library that the inventors of the algorithm provided, which uses all those SIMD intrinsics, versus the Rust, which uses our built-in SIMD support. So yeah, the times are basically the same. The results exactly the same. The library, which was implemented by Grievous Heart, is very cool. I should say that the benchmark I've done here has a patch, like a 4-line patch, to get it to be the same speed, because as I said, our SIMD support isn't perfect, and so there's a slight hack that you have to do with unsafe to be able to index into an array efficiently. Not to avoid bounce checking, just to be able to convert an array of SIMD types into an array of non-SIMD types. So anyway, another thing that's cool with Rust is traits. So for our std rand library, to get a random number, we've got this rand trait implemented for a few types, and then you can use the rand random function to create random values. So this is creating a random byte, it's creating a random 64-bit integer, 16-bit integer. And then Alex and I, a little while ago, came up with this neat trick that you can also implement rand for the random number generators. So exactly like the integers, you get a random number generator. It's like creating a random seed using the thread local random number generator in whatever format is preferred by the RNG you've selected. So for the XOR shift, that's 128 bits. For cha-cha, that's a few bits more. And then that will feed that into the random number generator, the implementation you've chosen, randomly initialize it, and give you a random number generator with a random seed in a very nice way. So anyway, I think that's, it was a very neat thing that when we invented it. The next thing is the community with Rust. So there's, like, a little while ago, some people picked over the documentation we had, because our std::ran documentation talks a little bit about dev-urandom and dev-random and how to interact with the operating system. And so some people picked over it very carefully and made sure that we were saying correct things and recommending the right advice. And then a month or two ago, Sneeves, or Sneeves, implemented ChaCha into the standard library. It's not all been integrated properly yet, but that will improve as we get closer to 1.0. And then, even more recently, Klutzy and Strokat got us to implement the getRandom syscall on Linux. So this fixes some of the problems that existed with devRandom and devURandom, and is a more reliable interface to the operating system's random number generator. So you can get all of that. Like, this all automatically happens when you use the std::rand:os:rng random number generator, which is what you should be using for anything cryptographically secure. So that will automatically choose the appropriate interface to the operating system's random number generator. It's documented as exactly what it's choosing on the documentation. So if you go to the std::rand:os:rng page, it will describe how it chooses getRandom, how it chooses, how it falls back to devURandom, and how it uses the appropriate things on Windows and on OS X and on BSD, I assume. So yeah, I think our random story isn't perfect. We aren't necessarily encouraging the use of the operating system enough, but the std::rand library will be analyzed soon, hopefully. Alex and Aaron will be having a look at that in the stability passes, I imagine. And I'm sure they'll be looking for feedback. But yeah, I think that's all I've got to say. Any questions? I guess my talk should have just been use std::rand:os:rng, but that wouldn't have been very interesting.
All right, thank you very much.
This is Nick Ferns?
Yeah, that's Nick Ferns. All right, last but not least, we have Sebastien. Hopefully I'm saying your name correctly. I'm probably not. Bright and early. I think it's 6 a.m. where you are. Oh, I can't hear you yet. Hold on. Okay, how about now?
It works?
Yes, it does work. Okay.
Okay. I did not sleep.
Here we go. You know, there's everybody.
Hi, you guys.
All right. Here's Sebastien.
So. That's good? Okay. So I'm Sebastien Martini, and I'm going to talk about memory allocations and crypto data. But first, a small disclaimer. First, like many of us, I think I'm still new to Rust, and I'm still learning new stuff all the time. And also, this small project is only a partial solution to a much more difficult problem. I'm mostly experimenting with IDs. So, What is the goal? The goal is to protect secrets and crypto data stored in memory during crypto operations. And to protect this data, we want to protect their memory locations. And the first thing to do, of course, is to use a memory safe language like Rust. It prevents a big sharing of memory issues. But even in this case, there is still room for unsafe code. For example, either through external C code or even in Rust itself, if you use too much unsafe blocks. So an additional protection is to implement some protection directly on memory allocations. And once we do that, we can build on top of them some data containers that will be that will use these functionalities. So currently, general purpose allocators are quite complex and mainly focus on performances rather than memory protection. So we need a more specialized allocator, one that will be used only for a subset of all allocations, the allocation of crypto data. And it will be designed specifically for this purpose. And if we analyze the main types of data used in crypto, we can see some patterns. There are two main types of data. One is secret key and messages, and other one tends to be crypto data structures and crypto states. They are quite different. Secret keys tend to be short, used quite infrequently, persistent in memory, and whereas crypto data tends to be short, have a short lifetime, and used much more frequently. So with that in mind, I implemented a small memory allocator just for this purpose. It's named TARS. It's largely inspired by OpenBSD MyLock, which provides a lot of boot protections. At a night level, it's just a replacement for the malloc and free functions. Internally, it's based on MMAP. And one thing to know is that all memory operations related to MMAP are applied on memory pages. That means that the granularity is a page of memory. And a page of memory is usually 4 kilobytes on most architectures. So the main features of this allocator are the following. It can allocate small chunks of data without wasting too much space by grouping them together. It's quite important because in crypto, a lot of allocations tend to be of small buffers. For instance, consider the following size of buffer used in some toy implementations. ChaCha uses 64 bytes buffer, then we have a 68 bytes buffer, 200 bytes, 208 bytes. These are quite small buffers, at least a lot smaller than a full page of memory. Also, this allocator implements fine-grained access control that allow to modify memory protections. That means that we can this memory buffer cannot be accessed at all, or can only be read, or can only be written, and things like that. Also, of course, we want to be able to zero out memory regions as soon as the corresponding Rust object is dropped. We don't want the data to live any longer. This allocator uses two types of allocation. The first one is for allocating small chunks of data by grouping them together on the same page, on a single page. And the second one is for larger objects by storing them alone in a memory region directly returned by a call to MMAP. And in both cases, they use guarded pages before and after their respective buffers that could help prevent, for instance, buffer overruns. And a guarded page is just a page of memory that cannot be accessed and otherwise the process is killed. Also, it's important to mention that because the granularity of memory protection is applied also on a page of memory, we cannot change individual memory protection on chunks when they are grouped together on the same page. So if we want to be able to change the memory protection of chunks, we have to allocate it alone in a page alone. We'll see that later. So now that we have an allocator, we can build on top of it some data containers. The first one is protbuf. This is in Rust, of course. Protbuf is a protected buffer. It's a fixed length array with read-write access to its memory, and it takes an allocator as type parameter. You can switch allocators. For instance, I can use the standard heap allocations function and things like that for testing. And the default allocator uses both types of allocation we have seen in the previous slide. That means this is well, it is well adapted for allocating small chunks of data used in internal operations. Let's see an example. So this example allocates a 42 bytes buffer initialized to zero, and it is parametered with the protected buffer allocator as allocator. Then we can access its elements, read them or void them, for instance, by using the method asmuteSlice. And slice are very useful for accessing raw memory, and also it's very convenient to use a slice because it's widespread in all the Rust code. So the second data container, protkey, is a protected key. It's basically a protbuf with restricted memory accesses. It is instantiated by taking ownership of a protbuf. And the main difference is that it uses a different allocator. It uses an allocator that makes sure that two different chunks are not allocated on the same page, because we want to apply individual memory protection on them. And by default, a protkey, its memory cannot be accessed at all. It's a bit like with protnum, like a guarded patch. This is by default. We have to make some explicit requests to access its memory. Let's see that in second example. So this example allocates a 32 bytes buffer with random bytes, and it used a different allocator, protected key allocator. Then we use this buffer to instantiate a protkey. It is moved into becoming a key, and this key by default cannot be accessed. And for instance, to read the content of the key, we have to call the method readWith and pass a closure as argument. And only the body of the closure can access the content of the key, and only for its lifetime, for its scope. After that, the memory cannot be accessed anymore. So there are still open issues because the code is not perfect, and the main issue comes down to the fact that it's difficult to control LLVM code generation and optimization. For instance, in the worst case, MSAT code could be optimized out from the generated code. Currently, the code uses the function volatile set memory that should prevent this issue from happening, but I'm not sure about that. I must say I don't have enough knowledge about LLVM actually. And the second potential issue is, for instance, when arithmetic operations are performed between elements of two protected buffers, the intermediary result could be storage in a variable put on the stack instead of using a register. And for instance, if there is too much register pressure, and we cannot prevent that. Actually, maybe we should investigate using inline assembly, but I don't know. This is something we need to think about. Also, of course, this is not because the assembly code of a particular compilation would be flawless, that the result on a different architecture or the result with the next version of LLVM would be flawless too. They could have some issues, there is no guarantee. And of course, when you manipulate protective buffers, we must take care of using them with other at-level language construction that may abstract details and that may do things internally that we do not anticipate, like copying data and stuff like that. So it's difficult to mix protective buffer with other parts of the Rust language. So there are also other limitations, but there are more because the project is young, nothing blocking, and many also this allocator is slow compared to other types of allocator. So this is project TARS. It's available on GitHub, of course, and of course feedbacks are welcome, and thanks for your time. So any question?
Questions?
Yes. I thought the connection was killed.
No. Yeah, it's still good. No. Okay. Well. We have one.
Hey, this is Tony. I mean, to me, like, there's a wide range of memory protection strategies you could have. So one is exactly what you're doing, which is great, which is using things like guard pages, protect, and that kind of thing. But an alternative strategy might be key wrapping. So you could encrypt the data when it isn't in use, right? You could keep that master key in, like, a TPM or some, like, a secure enclave on iPhone or something, right? And keep it secure. So how can you provide an API such that it's generic across those use cases?
There is no easy answer. I think it's difficult. It's difficult. I don't know. Because you have to maintain a secure buffer from end to end, and I think it's very, very difficult, actually. There's so much stuff. I don't know. I'm sorry.
Like everything with crypto, it's hard.
Yes, and there are more easier problems to solve that are not resolved before.
Yeah. Any other questions? All right. Well, thank you, Sebastian.
Thank you.
I think that brings us to the end of our longest meetup ever, I'm pretty sure. I think there are at least going to be a couple of people sticking around tonight if you want to hang out and chat for a bit. Otherwise, have a lovely evening, and thank you. See you in a month.